I grew up and I did it, is artists usually then tend to, at the beginning, have to do something to survive to then get to their dream, unless they're fortunate enough to come out of college and become fantastic, which usually they don't, because only about less than 10% are actually, maybe I better not use the mic, are very popular and immediately make it. So that's the avenue that I took, and I'm just gonna give you a funny little story on how that took place. I grew up in New York, and for an artist, first off, I'm sure as you can see that I'm an African-American, there's not very many artists that are African-American, but growing up in New York, my playground was the Guggenheim Metropolitan Museum of Art, and all of the galleries there. So just quickly, in speaking about being an entrepreneur, once I went through high school, great school called Brooklyn Tech, and then I went off to Pratt Institute, one of the top art schools in the country. Soon afterwards, in going back through Soho, where I watched that place form, looking in the window, and I see the artwork in there, and I said, wow, gee, I can do as good as this. So, in speaking about the entrepreneurship, I walked in and started talking to the owner, but of course I didn't have slides. I'm a young kid, maybe about 19, 20, 21. So I don't have a camera and all the slides like a lot of these artists to show the work. So I actually went home and got my work. He wanted to see it and brought it down to him on the subway. One which was a Masonite piece about 4 feet by 4 feet by 6 feet, cut in half, carrying on the subway. So I show up to his Soho gallery and people are looking. Look at this, young African American artist. And we're talking about with the difficulty of getting funding. Now, I'm young, 20, 21, I need to pay the rent, and I need to eat. And also, my mind is thinking, being young, that I'm as good as Picasso. So when he tells me that he'd like to put my work in the gallery on consignment, you know, the way that I was raised is, this is not a job, I don't have a job, I'm not getting paid. So he says, well, what do you think about that? You do know what consignment is. Yeah, I do. And when I go home, my parents are gonna say, hey, listen, you didn't get a job. You have your work somewhere that you hope that the guy is gonna sell it. So that's one of the difficulties as an artist. And just the funny twist to that is at that young age of 20, 21, I walked out of a Soho gallery and took my work. He says, well, would you like to leave it here? And I said, no, because I needed to make money. And this is a lot of times too, but what happens, what I'm doing here is using technology. I took a note from a lot of the hip-hop rappers, you know, where they read the lyrics from their phones. So I have my notes on the phone also. So what happens is a lot of times you'll have friends and so on in your family, and they'll just tell you, hey, listen, why don't you get a real job? Because what they consider your talent for is not a real job. Because, you know, what you are is actually is a creative. And a lot of that nowadays, especially, I think, is hard to come by because the creative thought process is really not examined and taught in most of the undergrad schools. You know, I'm talking about junior high schools and high school level. Independent thinking and creativity is not there. We want you to memorize this and memorize this and that. We don't want you to solve it on your own, but we just want you to follow the instructions. What happens that I believe here is that in the environment that you're in, creatives actually think with a different part of the brain. I think a lot of people, I'm not sure if it's the left or the right. I believe it's the left. So the regular people that you're thinking about that have jobs in industry, police, fire, you know, are right thinking. And what this does is the creative person and the artist tend to look at things in a different perspective. And I want to something as an example that I call it is simply as the bridge. I was talking to John about this. As an artist that's been here in Greenville since 2006, moving from New York, I found it very interesting to get involved in a lot of things in City Hall, urban planning, and what we're going to do in uptown revitalization, because I would walk through Fifth Street and realize, wow, this looks like the old village. So I went to a final meeting that they had for uptown revitalization, that they were concerned on building this big thoroughfare, provided hospital that was going to connect through in the downtown hub and connect with ECU University. And going around and looking at all the plans on the wall, now I'm a student that came out of industrial design in Pratt Institute, so I'm looking at all the architectural drawings, easy to understand, and the blueprints, and I'm looking and I'm saying, wow, they've got this big thing, they're widening the roadways, and I'm talking to a lot of the architects here, and it's going to go right through that Dickinson Avenue train, which I know from driving around and taking my kids to and from school, could be 110 cars, I might have to wait for 15 or 20 minutes. So with my creativity and the artist, I brought up the point, well, look, you know, don't you think that there might be another alternative? I don't see any plans here for a bridge. And they said, well, you know, we've been kicking that around since 1958, 1959, and they've kind of shot it down and turned it down all. So what my point, and as an artist, in looking at things in a different perspective than most people usually do, you say that you're building this to uplift the future, and you're looking towards the few dignitaries, big people, doctors, and so on, traveling in from the highway and coming into East Carolina University and the face of Greenville for the future, and the face of the future is going to stop at a railroad crossing for 110 cars? So the answer I got was, okay, you can write that down and you can put it there, but we can submit it to Raleigh and perhaps, you know, we don't know, maybe they'll go for it. So what my point here is that an artist in being out in the community, I made it my point to be so powerful with that statement of why you have to have it, bring it back, do whatever, because for the next 5 to 10 years, you're going to have people stopping at a railroad instead of going over with this future uplifting. So this is one thing where you're talking about the challenges and so on, where I think that artists can really be effective in the community. And one other thing is we're talking about with Greenville. And Greenville, in terms of the artists, what I was looking at, the area, which is why I came from New York, is supposed to be known and is known for health, Vital Hospital, big hospital, almost on par with Duke, and East Carolina University, one of the best teaching universities in the planet. I've talked to some students that were studying medical from Israel, one of the jobs I was working, and they told me personally, hey, listen, you didn't know that East Carolina has one of the finest medical schools that gives you hands-on experience in the world. That's why we're here from Israel. And the other thing is arts and entertainment. But the arts and entertainment is lacking. Like someone else mentioned, you have a couple of the pubs downtown. And what happens with the arts and entertainment we have, it's geared around the monetization and just making a dollar or so on beer and this and that for the students, and restrictive in terms of, well, what kind of music do we want to have, and hip-hop, and no, and it. So the arts and entertainment isn't on an intellectual level that is the same as the university and the town. It's kind of on a lower a level, and the first thing that you need to do is have that artistic level at that height. Now, what it really calls for, like with this farm bill, because this is what happens, you have all of these students graduating, people that are here locally, they leave the town because there's nothing here, so they go off to Raleigh and elsewhere, and I'm going out to a club in Raleigh, and the money leaves because we're not developing, as us, the artists, the arts and the entertainment here, we something like the Medici family or something to happen and occur. Because the school that I went to, Pratt, was created to teach students what to do in the new industrial age. They needed machines, and they needed people who knew how to design these steam engines, machines. So the Carnegies and the Pratts that became Pratt and Whitney and everyone got together, and they said, hey, we're gonna build Pratt Institute. We'll design and make our own artists. But now, there's not those jobs anymore with the manufacturing that's taken over by machines. So this is a different age, which I call, or I believe and think is, an artist is one of the age of enlightenment. So to keep people interested and to be here, because if you're gonna have an advanced community in Greenville, you're gonna wanna attract young people that have something to do after they finish at DSM Pharmaceutical and all of the companies. It's gotta be an interesting nightlife besides just going out and eating and having dollar beers. I've got a hospital here. So now that there's no art, so that's where it calls for an investment where some of the pharmaceutical companies or someone like the Medici family, that's what they were doing, is nurturing the arts. You think about New York with the public libraries that they had there. I forget who was the man who went out and built it, but he just built all of these libraries as a philanthropist, which I can't really say that word well for whatever reason. But these things would just need to happen by someone enlightened enough to figure out that that's the seed project. I've got to start seeding him. I've got to buy Budo's glass. I've got to have King Edward in performance. I've got to buy this disruptive artist because I work in all digital. I've taken all my brushes and paints and thrown them out. Since 2006, I work with a stylist. My best work is viewed on a digital display panel or output in a fashion called the Giclée fashion, which is printed with a high inkjet printer. I've had students from ECU overlooking and seeing my work early in 2006 and wondering, what the heck are you doing? Hey, I'm outputting digital work. This is experimental. Anyway, I'm going to move on. I'm not sure how I am on time, but in building a brand, you've got to find out what is your niche in your brand. Like you're talking about glass blowing. Edwin is talking about music and hip hop, and you need to take a look at the market, and you actually have to do evaluation on the market. And the main thing is, once you're doing all this, that you have to realize what a lot of artists may not is your brand is your word. And if your word is not good, then you don't have a good brand, because you end up having to live up to your word. If you're saying that I'm going to produce this album, this event, this work, you need to produce it. And actually, in terms of the self-confidence of artists, because now I have a lot of friends who do that with me. Yeah, man, you know, you need to get a job, go back to doing the security, this, that, and the other. Now, in terms of your word is really powerful with artists, is because now no matter what kind of art that I do, if I just do art like this, just do like that and say, okay, that was my performance piece, right? I can stand on that because I said so. I'm an artist because I said so. I don't need anyone else's validation. Artists don't need anyone else's validation to validate their art. They are artists because they create, they know they are, and that's exactly what it is, which is why a lot of times us artists are kind of hard to talk with and figure out. One good point that I wanted to bring up there on going into the leveraging social media. This is where I've become an animal in social media. I'm out on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. I kind of started with, even my kids would say, Dad, I grew up on that, and my main problem as a youngster growing up, I was into art and music. I would see Andy Warhol. I loved Jackson Pollock work, and he lived out on Long Island, but he never came to my school. You know, I tried to go to a couple local schools there, and they weren't too agreeable on that. But what my problem was, I never got to talk to Picasso or Dalí. They died, and he didn't have a word with me. Nothing. That always the artist stayed aloof. That's old school. This is the 21st century. So if the artist is not social, then that's where your brand, the monetization, everything is down in the toilet. You really have to understand how to leverage social media and to engage with the people. King Edward knows me. I do a lot of work with live streaming. I started with that another job of making food for my family, an experimental streaming company that was delivering HBO and Showtime in the mid-90s in New York and Brooklyn. We microwaved it to a set-top box that then turned into all of this YouTube and everything streaming to your house. Let's see, I kind of lost my train of thought there. But in leveraging the social media, this is where I was going, is what a lot of artists that I've noticed tend to do, and I'm going to keep it as clean as possible, and even different type of artists, not only the music ones, they just get on the internet and social media, buy my ish, look at this, I got this on sale, buy this. So in social media, I mean, this is what a lot of people don't realize, artists and regular people, this is wrong. You're talking to people. It's social media, like this meeting we're having here. You want to talk with your audience. You want to engage them. So this is what I do out on Facebook. I have two verified properties out on Facebook. I have an AKA like King Edward VII. I found out that there was a black pirate that ran with Blackbeard called Black Caesar. So in music, I became Black Caesar. Yeah, Black Caesar pirate hat into hip hop. And I engage with fans. Yeah, so what do you do? Well, I got artists like King Edward VII. And, well, can I send you my music? Yeah, it's good. And if it's good, I'll play it. If it's not, we'll throw you overboard to the sharks. Now, I may be being fictitious and getting people to enjoy it, but this is engagement with people. Also, on my art site, what I'm doing is disruptive. I'm an avant-garde artist. I believe in you know, my theology on how art is art is the vanguard of the people. All artists do, if you're around artists, watch them. All they do is observe and look, just like that camera that's there. They're watching everything. It might come out in King Edward's song. It might come out in one of Mr. Budo's lessons and something he wants to do. It might come out in something that John is going to do. And this is what artists do. They mirror and reflect and record society. They are the real digital cameras and computers. So this is where it's really important to leverage that social media with all of the different tools. You have things like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and depending on what your audience is, instead of buy my stuff, you can consider a soft sell. You know, you're on Facebook and you're talking about a race that they're running in Greenville, a 5K to benefit so-and-so, and you post that ad there, and with one of the pictures that talks about the article, and you're talking about the article, you might insert one of your pieces of glass in there and say, hey, yeah, look at this. This is one of my newest works. that's about covers, I think, the three topics that I have. If anyone had any questions.